Welcome everybody to our bonus podcast. Only Thaleia and I are here today because Nancy is listening to our own advice in terms of this podcast. We're talking about burnout and balance, and she said, I need a day off.
Yeah.
So she is home today dealing with some stuff and having a rest. So that's good.
Well, they've been doing a lot of apologetics stuff.
Yeah.
They had their Friday night last night, and they have something coming up this week, so it's very busy.
Yeah, and she's volunteered to be the hot lunch mom at her school.
Oh.
So I think she's counting hot dog orders
or something. So it's not really a rest. It's
I think today she is having a rest. But yeah, that has been her thing. So anyways, that's great. We're glad to give her a break. And the last couple of Fridays, it just has seemed that Thaleia and I have quickly ran out to grab a Tim Hortons and had a half-hour chat. So we'll kind of structure this like our, as if we're chatting in the car. Tim Hortons and back. We wanted to just talk first a little bit about just some of our favorite things at Northview here on the weekend, and then some upcoming things that are happening in women's ministry. So what would you say some of your favorite things here are on the weekend? You were on duty all weekend. You baptized on Saturday, and
yes,
you did emceed all three services Sunday.
I did. It was a full weekend, but an exciting weekend. So baptized three women, which was so exciting. The water's warm, for anybody who's wondering.
Yeah. You get the nice one. I always have to do the cultist lake one.
I know that was great.
That works. Yeah.
And then for the first time ever, I was the MC in Center Court. I'm usually scheduled for Worship Center.
So you've never done it before?
One evening service.
That's it.
Okay. And one Christmas Eve, I think.
Yeah.
But it was a while ago. So it was kind of felt new.
Yeah, that's fine.
So the tech people were so kind, and they were kind of walking me through it. So it was great. And it was so nice to see new faces that we don't always see in the worship center.
Yeah.
So it was a treat. And then Sunday night gathering was new again for me. I'd never been to the new formatted Sunday night gathering. And that was great. Farmer's Sausage on a Bun.
Okay.
At 5 o'clock. It was great. I hear that they sometimes have sandwiches, but that was really super. And then just visiting and worship and a shorter message. Jeremy Lobdell spoke for half an hour. More prayer, worship, singing. It was great. Casual. The lighting is dim. It was just really nice.
Yeah, I've talked to one person in particular who came from a smaller church in Winnipeg, and they've loved Northview, but just really stressing about the size of it. It just was getting to her after a while. And when the Sunday night service came up, it was just, she came right away as that first week with her family, and they've come every week since, because it just feels like, oh yeah, this is more like home, a smaller size and a more relaxed format maybe.
Yeah. And our family, Mark and I and our kids, we are Saturday night people.
Mm-hmm.
We love Saturday nights. We've gone since Carter was a baby, so like 15 years. And we love the dinner because, well, it's selfish, right? They make a great meal here. I don't have to cook and I don't have to do dishes.
No dishes,
and
then, make them home.
Yeah. And then in the last few weeks, we've been about 5 o'clock or so. We go from the dinner and we go hang out in the cove, that area with the new couches.
Yeah.
And then lots more people come through there. So you just have this really great visiting time for an hour, like 4:30 to 5:30 before the service starts.
Yeah.
It's just great. And then more visiting after the service with
the coffee. Yeah. It's a 3-hour social.
I know.
I think that's one of my favorite things, is just the variety of services and how you could come to a different one every week, and it would just have a different feel and a different flavor.
Yeah.
Even the 9 a.m. compared to the 11 a.m. in Center Court is a little bit different.
Different
crowd. And yeah, so it's neat to have all those different options available.
I know, and my kids like coming to different services because they have some friends at the Saturday night, but then if we can't go Saturday night, then we'll go Sunday at 11 o'clock, Center Court.
Yeah.
And we have the community time in the middle, and there's different teenagers there that they wouldn't normally see Saturday night, so it's a different kind of visiting for them.
Right.
So we try to mix it up so that we kind of have the benefit of all the flavors.
Yeah.
Yeah.
It's good. And this Saturday night was extra special with the baptism. That was just really fun to have, see 14 people getting baptized and go through that. We thought we'd also just give you a few updates as to some things that are happening in the next little while in women's ministry. For the women that are listening, we have our retreat coming up at the end of January, and so we just opened up registration online. So we just really encourage you to check that out and come take a look at what we're doing. Next week, Monday, a group of us are going to go down to Warm Beach Camp and Conference Center. It's a new location. We're going to go down, take a whole bunch of pictures, do a kind of an advanced scouting out so that we can kind of give you guys a visual of what it's going to be like.
That's
so,
a good idea.
Yeah, so look for those pictures maybe end of October, and we'll send out maybe some video clips and that kind of stuff so you can see what it's all about. And
registration closes a little earlier this year, right?
Yeah.
When are you wanting to close that?
I think it's the second week in January, so about 3 weeks before the event. They need the hard numbers.
Okay.
So yeah, so we want to really encourage people to register early, and I think December 1st is our early bird cutoff. So we'll have that all on the website. But okay. Yeah, to think about.
Yeah.
It'll be fun. It's always open to teenage girls and up. And it's just really a great time. So we're looking forward to a new location and just trying that out.
Our daughters have really enjoyed the last few years.
They have.
Yeah, it's been a highlight for them.
It has been just great. And when you think of the fact that you want them to grow up in the church and to communities where they feel connected, and
yeah,
just helps build those bridges and
yeah,
makes it feel like women's ministry may not be such a weird thing as they get older.
Yeah,
and they get lots of natural mentoring that happens and just fun. So
yeah. And we're in the States this time, a little further down, so that there's outlet shopping.
There is. All the boys roll their eyes whenever we mention that, but hey, whatever works.
No, it's true.
That's not why we chose to change it.
No, it's just fresh.
But it's fun.
It's something different.
Yeah, and a bigger facility for our meeting rooms, which will make it great, so we don't have to feel as squashed in there. So yeah, so that's good. And also a women's mission trip coming up in spring. So we're just starting to get the word out that way. We've been going to Panda Vida, Mexico, to the Children of Hope Orphanage for a couple of years, and we will be doing that again this year.
Oh.
So April 25th to May 4th, I think. So,
how many women do they take?
Generally 15 is the maximum, 10 to 15.
Okay.
Yeah, and it's working with the kids in the orphanage, doing some projects, whatever they kind of call us to do, and often some kind of teaching component or devotional with kids and the staff and that kind of stuff. So yeah, it'll be good.
Yeah.
Today we were wanting to talk about burnout, as I mentioned when we were introducing. So Thaleia, you deal with a lot of women in this church here. How often do you see people feeling like they're burnt out or
You and I both, when we were talking about this topic, we both know people who have gone through burnout. And those we are watching because they could be on the path to burnout.
Yeah.
This is a reality in our super busy culture.
How would you define it?
So burnout. We would say that a state of burnout is someone who's just completely exhausted, emotionally exhausted, physically exhausted, socially exhausted, spiritually. It's hard to get out of bed. It's hard to put one foot in front of the other. It's hard to do your tasks of whether it's home or job or school. Like, it's just, you are completely drained.
Yeah. You just got nothing left to give.
No.
Anybody.
Yeah. No.
Why would somebody reach that point? What do you think are the main reasons people go down that path?
Let's talk about that, because there are so many reasons why someone would end up being burnt out or is on the path to being burnt out. So we'll go back and forth, but one of the examples that people always are concerned about for me is the emotional burdens. And that's a lot of people. That could be nurses, social workers, pastors, people who are in the helping professions. When you hear a lot of emotional muck all the time, like we do, it takes a toll. And so then over time, if it's too heavy a load over too long a time, the fear and the worry is that someone could end up being burnt out.
Because people tend to enter vicariously into other people's situations. They want to be able to help, and they want to be able to solve. And
the load is heavy, and you can't necessarily fix people's problems. And so then you end up feeling hopeless, and you feel angry that people aren't changing their lives.
Yeah.
And, you know, it just starts to really take a toll.
Yeah. Physical burdens can do it too. Some people are working hard to make ends meet, and they're working two or three jobs, or they have, especially single parents maybe, doing a lot of the daily jobs around the house. No one else to kind of help them out, so they're just like running from morning till night, and no time to rest.
One of the wives and moms in our congregation still laughs when she sees me, because I joked with her that I was going to give her a spanking a couple years ago, where she had a whole bunch of things on her plate, you know, homestay students and aging parents and her own family and a job and on. And I was like, what? Okay, if you take on one more thing, I'm going to give you a spanking. And she still brings it up, because it was her way of recognizing, okay, there's a point when I have to say no to something.
And sometimes other people help us see that better.
Yeah.
We think, oh, I can just handle this. I can just do it.
But yeah, she listened though.
Yeah.
Yeah, she laughs with me now. That's good.
I know. You didn't actually have to spank her, which is
No.
I think the drive to succeed, perfectionism, wanting to be really good at something. And I think all of these, emotional, physical, can be in all age groups. But I think perfectionism, these things can be really high in teenage kids and university
students.
They feel a lot of pressure to make the grades, to get into university, to stay in university, to keep scholarships.
Yeah, we see breakdowns in a teenage level or younger. Yeah. We see breakdown in young men and women who are just trying to get the best grades and get into the best schools and also hold down jobs and it just adds up.
Yeah.
Businessmen too, who are striving to, you know, do their best for their business and they're putting their all into it, but eventually the load gets too heavy.
Yeah, you just can't keep going. Yeah.
No, and of course the supermom syndrome.
Yes.
You know, I'm not a supermom, so
have you ever been? Like, have you ever kind of tended to want to be?
No, or? But I have. I have a couple of friends that are super moms, and I bug them and now and then just so that they see that they go a little far sometimes. And these are moms that want to do it all, which is not a wrong desire.
Yeah.
You know, they want to bake from scratch, and they want to volunteer in their classroom, and they want to hold a job, and they want to and they try to do everything, and it's just very hard to live up to that.
Yeah.
Yeah, and eventually they fall apart.
And sometimes it can be, like you said, for good reasons. Sometimes mm-hmm. it can be a bit of a pride reason.
Yeah.
Or a, you know,
that badge of busyness.
Yeah.
Yeah. You want, the, I can do it all.
You want people to think that you're important and you have
yeah,
it.
Yeah. Yeah. Decorate my home and work out and have a job and pets and whatever. Oh, goodness.
Yeah.
This just makes me tired thinking about it. We're going to have a nap after this podcast.
After the burnout. We'll burn out after this one. We've talked about this in other ones too, in the adversity when we talked about this a little bit, but that desire to save people.
Oh,
we
yeah.
want to have the savior complex. We want to be the one that swoops in and makes everything all right
mm-hmm.
and helps somebody out of a jam. And so that desire to be a savior
yes.
can really lead to
yes.
bad habits.
I talked about yeah. this once to new pastors who were being credentialed with the MB conference. And we talked about this because for pastors or people in the helping profession, you know, we want to be people pleasers and we want to help out. So we'll take those emergency calls late at night or in the middle of a yeah. meal or on the weekends, and we'll continue to rescue people all the time, putting our needs last.
Yeah.
But eventually, of course, that hurts us because we are physical people who need rest and all those kinds of things.
And eventually it doesn't necessarily help that person often.
Like no.
sometimes people need that middle of the night help, but often it's just people that want more and more attention. And if we
yeah.
keep giving it to them, then...
Because we're a team. We anywhere. Need to work together. It can't just be one person meeting the needs of everybody.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So is there an ideal world that we can live in where we're always in harmony and balance and nothing ever flaps us and life is just so predictable? What do you think?
Well, my rant is this word balance. I really, really, really hate the word balance.
Oh, really, really,
yeah,
really?
Really, really. Because... if you think of, like Kristal had the idea of a Bosu ball or a wobble board, and you know if you stand on it, you might be able to achieve balance for a few seconds or a lot longer if you've had training. But most
you've
of us...
You've got the good core muscles.
I can barely get it up for 1 second. So if we try to live in balance, like every day, we just constantly are disappointed. We
yeah.
feel guilty all the time because we can't every day do everything that we should do. We have
yeah.
this idea that if I'm living a day in balance, then I should exercise and eat my veggies and do my spiritual Bible reading and my prayer and contact a good friend and take care of my house and go grocery shopping and my pets and my... And you just it just all falls apart.
Yeah.
We cannot do it over one day. So my rant is, please, if you have to use the word balance, then think of it more as over like a week
or even
over
a month. Yeah.
Yeah. Because that's a little bit more achievable. Although we know, you and I, your rant is that, well, it isn't like that. We have busy seasons and we have slower seasons.
Yeah.
And you had some stuff that you wanted to add to that.
Well, I just remember 1 week where like it was a really hard week. Both my grandfathers passed away and my 3 kids all had chicken pox at the same time. So I'm running in and out of funeral homes and trying to keep my kids away from people that haven't got, and like my house is a shambles and it was weeks for me to recover. But
yes,
you can't just say like
balance.
Feel guilty about that.
Yeah,
just have some balance. There's times where you just have to plow in, you know,
yeah.
put your nose to the grindstone, say this is going to be a crazy time, a crazy season, and get through it. Every September,
yes.
we kind of hit the ground
yeah.
after our August holidays, and we're bracing ourselves because we know till basically October 10th,
it's yeah, a whole month, it's going to be craziness.
It's going to
be
full throttle,
and in our homes, trying
yeah.
to get our kids settled into school.
Yeah, and so
yeah.
we can't in those times just pull back and say, "Well, I'm not going to do that because I need to be in balance."
Yeah,
we have to say, you know what, for this month. I just know that's going to be my reality.
Yeah.
But I can't sustain this
no.
forever and for a long time.
I think that's the important point, too, is that burnout isn't... You don't just have a crazy week and then you hit burnout.
No.
Like, burnout is something over a long term.
Yeah.
So if you have a crazy week or crazy month like we do every September, well, we don't hit burnout.
No.
We just realize we're tired.
Then
and
we
take
just
a break.
We plan ahead of time, taking
yeah.
this day off in October or whatever. Yeah.
Burnout could be months and years of
yeah.
too heavy responsibility, emotionally, physically, spiritually, whatever.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
But if we didn't recognize some of those cycles and kept adding on more in October
True.
And November, and yeah, then it would get there. But
And our church is really healthy that way. And you may not know that if you're our listeners.
Yeah.
But for example, I work 25 hours a week. And if I work regularly 30 hours a week, not a problem. If I start working 35 hours a week, they're going to have a conversation with me because I was hired for 25. Mm-hmm. But my work is flexible. And if I need to go home early in an afternoon, I can. Or if I need to take a day here or a day there, whatever. Because my work isn't consistent. It's wherever people need to meet with me. But our church is very, considerate, kind of. And
well, sometimes you
mindful.
Hear, yeah, sometimes you hear jobs where people jokingly say, well, they'll pay me for 20, but they expect me to work 40. But that's not the way it is here at Northview.
No.
You get in trouble if you're working 40 and they're paying you for 20.
Yeah.
And if you work overtime, they hope their goal is that you will take off those same kind of hours within that month.
Yeah, so your banked time.
Your banked time. So mm-hmm. you don't bank it for a year and then end up with 6 weeks off.
Yeah.
But instead you take a day or two a month to get caught up.
Yeah.
So I think that's healthy. And there's also on the flip side is some people who are so scared of getting involved that they use this balance as a cop-out, right?
Like, yeah, I don't want that. No, it's a laziness thing.
It's lazy. Like, I don't want anything to upset my life, so no, I'm not going to help out. I'm not going to, because I just want to be balanced. So
Yeah.
So how does burnout happen? Well, you said overnight. It's not overnight. It's a slippery slope. So what kind of thinking helps us go down that, or whatever, pushes us down that path?
So when I've talked to other groups about this, it often starts with feeling just tired and grumpy over a period of time, and then you start to feel resentful and then angry.
Yeah.
And then, you know, you start to get tired, and it just spirals. It gets out of control, and people around you can see it.
Yeah.
And they will sometimes tell you, oh, that's a pretty heavy load. Have you considered dropping this or stopping that or changing this? And we need to listen to those people because we don't always recognize it ourselves. But it's not something that happens over a week. It can take months to build up.
Yeah. We can develop less tolerance for things that you might have had tolerance for before, right? Comments or just people coming to you with issues. You can, if you sense yourself wanting to push people away rather than listen, because you're just like, I'm up to my eyeballs in issues I can't handle anymore.
Yeah, if someone's far too quick to burst into tears or burst into anger, or they're off emotionally for a long period of time, not just one day, not just one week, but over time you think, you know, this person isn't coping very well.
Yeah.
That might be time to have a conversation about, hey, what's going on in your life? What's on your plate? How are you managing all of this?
Yeah. And all of us are different in terms of how much we can handle.
Yeah.
Some of us need more downtime. Others, like my daughter, Jessica, like one of my friends laughs and says, well, it's a good thing she has so many friends, because she would tire one person out if they had to do everything with her, because she can just
go with
and
friends.
She, like, that energizes her.
Yes.
Right? Whereas me, I know I need a few evenings at home, or else I'm just done. I can't be out every night.
No, and it's okay that if we have different capacity levels.
It is, yeah.
So some people have a capacity to be very busy, and that energizes them, and they can manage it. And other people can only really manage one extra task other than their work, and that's totally fine. Like, make sure you hear us, that if you have a different energy level or different capacity level, it's fine. It just makes you unique and different. That's totally fine.
Yeah. There's no right or wrong in this one. It's just different.
No, and it's different stages of life. Like, I think about what I can handle now as opposed to when I was a mom with two kids back to back and I wasn't able to handle nearly what I can handle now.
Yeah.
Just a stage of life thing.
Yeah, and even just experience. I think the more you walk through different experiences, you learn how to handle them quicker.
Yeah.
And get through them quicker, whereas something might have taken you an hour to figure out at one point, and now you're, okay,
true.
I know how to do that now.
Yeah, that's true.
Yeah, so different capacities can change over time. So so what if you have people that have hit burnout, is there hope for them, or are they doomed?
They have asked me that question. If you've hit burnout, is it possible to recover?
Yeah.
And we know that our God is a God of recovery. So yes, 100% people can recover. But if you've hit burnout before, or you've come close, then you might be more prone to it another time. So you really have to take time to think, okay, how am I going to prevent this from happening a second time or a third time? This is something to watch for.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So while we should all have healthy boundaries all the time, once you've gone there once, you definitely have to be a lot more.
I think so. It's like a sickness. I remember when I was entering Bible college, I got a very bad case of laryngitis where I lost my voice. And for a number of years after that, every time I would get a cold, I would get laryngitis and I'd lose my voice. So almost like I became prone to it through that one illness.
Yeah.
I think it's like that with burnout. Once we get very close to burnout and we are really squashed and we are just really hurting emotionally, physically, spiritually, we could be prone to it again. So we just have to take extra time and energy to reevaluate our life. And we're going to talk about some of those solutions, because it's a big deal to take a break and really look at what's going on.
Yeah. And I think realize, like, it's like anything, that any wound that you have, mm-hmm. that as it's healing, it's just going to need some more TLC around it, right? Like, so it might just take a couple years.
Yeah.
And it might need a little bit of extra attention during that time. But as it, as you go further along, it's, you're going to become tougher again.
Yes.
But
you can recover. First, 100% you can recover.
But it just might take time.
Yeah.
Yeah. And it might take, So prevention, we want to talk about prevention and solutions. They're kind of the same thing.
They are.
Mm-hmm. So
years ago, I worked in mental health, and I was not allowed to actually work with people like on a counseling level until we had made sure that they had gone to a medical doctor, because we also had to do like an intake and make sure, are you sleeping?
Yeah.
If you're sleeping too much or too little, that's not a healthy sign. You know, a regular amount. Are you eating too much or too little? Are you taking your medications properly? You know, are you exercising? Do you have hobbies and interests? And we had to make sure people were sort of doing those things before we could do any counseling strategies. And the example I use all the time is, I meet with moms who want to maintain a good slim weight. Okay, that's a good desire. But if you're doing it by drinking coffee and eating crackers, well, that's not going to make you a very kind, thoughtful, intelligent mom. You're going to be grumpy and tired because our bodies are not made for coffee and crackers only.
Yeah.
So we need to eat well and we need to sleep well and take our medications. And that for me is the foundation of preventing burnout or solving it. You need to rest and you need to do what's healthy for the body that God has given us.
Yeah. So many times we skip past that and spiritualize all these things, right?
Yeah.
And we think, well, God should give me the strength to do all this.
And people are surprised when I do that because, you know, you and I are pastors here, so we should really first go to the Bible in prayer.
Yeah.
But I know, and you know, that people can't read their Bible or study their Bible well or even pray well if we're not eating and sleeping and doing those things correctly.
Their brain, yeah.
Yeah.
I know myself, if I miss lunch and try and keep working, no, you don't want to submit those.
Yeah, like, why do I have such a headache? It's too late. Oh, I didn't have lunch.
Yeah.
Yeah, okay, so take care of our bodies first so we can think properly.
So we were thinking, as we were talking about this burnout of examples in the Bible, and I guess the one that came to mind related to this topic was the story of Elijah.
Yes.
After he had this great Mount Carmel experience, and called down fire from heaven and totally got the whole prophets of Baal, you know, egg in their faces, I guess you'd say. And then Jezebel came after him and he ran away in fear into the wilderness. And it says that the angels came and cared for him for a certain number of days until he was well enough to continue on his way.
Yeah, it's in 1 Kings 19, 1-8. You can read it. It's very interesting. This man of God who has done all these amazing things is completely burned out. And what does he need? He needs food and rest water.
Quiet.
Yeah, quiet. It's a good one.
Yeah.
Yeah, that's an amazing story. And it just reminds us that we are human. Even the celebrity people around us are human.
And God made us with those needs. Mm-hmm. He made us with the requirements. So he wants us to honor his creation in taking care of our bodies and all that.
Yeah.
Priorities. How do we evaluate priorities and what's important and what we should let go of, what's unrealistic?
Yeah, that's a big discussion. And I would say that in this whole reevaluation stage, if you're on the way to burnout or if you're recovering from burnout, is meet with some trusted people in your life.
Yeah.
And ask them to help you reevaluate what needs to stay, what needs to go, what do you need to cut down on? It's different for each person. So it's not something that we can just say, here, cookie cutter, this is what you have to do.
No.
We say to people here at church that sometimes in a season of burnout, it's okay to hide. You can sit in the back row of church and simply sing and pray and scripture read and just be part of the service and learn from the teaching. There are seasons like that.
Mm-hmm.
And there are other seasons where you're recovered and ready to go and you volunteer and pitch in and it's great.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I think so many of the expectations we have for ourselves are unrealistic. So it's learning too to evaluate which are realistic and which are unrealistic. And which are important to the people around us and which aren't. I think sometimes I can get all stressed about filling a need that I think is important for my kids or for Bob or whatever. And then I realize, well, that's not really what they need.
Oh, yeah.
What they need is
time with mom.
They need me to sit on their bed and talk to them.
Yeah.
They don't need me to frantically be baking cookies.
Yeah.
And so I think it's evaluating too, you know, what is the best use of our time to fill the needs of the people that we really want to them to feel cared for.
You talked before about rethinking your pink and blue jobs. I thought that was great.
Yeah,
talk about that a little bit.
That was fun to think about because it's something that was a frustration point for Bob and I initially in our marriage because You know, in your mind, you have the pink jobs, which are the ones that the girls should do, and the blue jobs that the guys should do. And there was some blue jobs that he just hated doing. Like, he just doesn't like mowing the lawn doing the yard work and that kind of stuff. He hates doing it. But he doesn't mind doing grocery shopping and doing all these kind of errands, and I don't like doing those kind of things. So I would get annoyed at him that he didn't want to mow the lawn, and then I'd feel like I still had to do the grocery shopping because I'm the girl and that's what the girls do. And then we thought, well, this is stupid. I'll do the yard work. You do the shopping.
Nice.
And it's good.
Good cooperation.
But sometimes we get so locked into these kind of what society said, well, this is your place, this is your role, that we don't then just think, well, what... Let's divide it based on what we like to do.
So a team approach is what we talked about before, realizing that it's not up to me to do everything in my life. We're a team for a reason, whether it's a family or friendship group or a church co-working group like we have here. Co-working group. You know, like a team.
Yeah. And with every... There usually seems to be one person, like in a family specifically, that'll take on the roles that really should be managed by a group of people. Yeah. And so there's always that one responsible person.
Like the family CEO?
Yeah. But they are the ones that are prone to be, feeling the burnout because they feel the responsibility, the weight to carry everybody else.
Yeah, and the problem with that is if that person does all the jobs and they don't delegate or allow other people to pitch in, then other people are allowed to be lazy.
Yeah.
And that is to the detriment of your family as opposed to the person who's doing all the work. So, yeah, it's a big deal. What about the story of Moses? In Exodus 18, there's a story of Moses who... I'll read it to you. You'll hear it. It's starting at verse 13. Exodus 18, starting at 13. The next day, Moses sat to judge the people, and the people stood around Moses from morning till evening. When Moses' father-in-law saw all that he was doing for the people, he said, "What is this that you are doing for the people?" Don't you notice? That's the father-in-law who's speaking into Moses, the big cheese guy. "Why do you sit alone and all the people stand around you from morning till evening?" And Moses said to his father-in-law, "Because the people come to me to inquire of God. When they have a dispute, they come to me and I decide between one person and another and I make them know the statutes of God and his laws." Moses' father-in-law said to them, "What you are doing is not good. You and the people with you will certainly wear yourselves out, for the thing is too heavy for you." Hear that? Burned out.
Yeah.
"You are not able to do it alone. Now obey my voice. I will give you advice and God be with you. You shall represent the people before God and bring their cases to God. And you shall warn them about the statutes and the laws and make them know the way in which they must walk and what they must do. Moreover, look for able men from all the people, men who fear God, who are trustworthy and hate a bribe, and place such men over the people as chiefs of thousands, of hundreds, of fifties, and of tens. And let them judge the people at all times. Every great matter they shall bring to you, but any small matter they shall decide for themselves. So it will be easier for you, and they will bear the burden with you. If you do this, God will direct you. You will be able to endure, and all this people also will go to their place in peace." It's an amazing passage.
It's good for
passage.
Everybody. Not just good for Moses, good for everybody.
It's good for everybody. Yeah. It's a team.
Yeah.
Yeah.
We see the same story in the apostles in the early church. When they said there was so many needs from the poor people, and so they delegated or they devised a team of elder or deacons at the time to fulfill the needs so that they could do the preaching and teaching ministry.
Yeah,
and so that's a wise thing. Just say, well, what are your gifts? What are your strengths? And allow each others to use each other's gifts and strengths to serve together in the church. So that's what we wanted to kind of end with. Encouraging everybody to evaluate where you are getting your strength. Yeah. Like that's a great way to think
how
about
you being
how to cope with burnout. So what are the things that are filling you up? What are the things that energize you? So we had examples physically. So hobbies, interests, exercise, golfing, tennis, running, walking. What are those physical things that you enjoy? Emotionally, time alone, time with supportive friends, counseling. What are the things that can fill you up? This is different for everybody, obviously.
Yeah.
Spiritually, being at church regularly, Bible reading, Bible study, prayer, retreats. And socially, supportive family and friends.
Yeah. These
Anything
are great
else
things
you'd
to consider.
Add to that list?
No, I think that's a good start. I mean, Kristal and I know that if you think that you or someone close to you is struggling with possible burnout or is heading in that direction, you're so welcome to come and talk to us.
Yeah.
and we can talk about this further, because we realized that we're doing a half hour podcast, but we could talk about this for hours because it's unique and individual to each person. So what will send someone to burnout won't send the next person to burnout. And what are the signs in one person might be slightly different than the signs in another person.
Yeah. But having, yeah, sitting down with us and having us kind of map out all the different things that you're doing and which are the ones that are stressors and which are the ones that are good in terms of your mental health and physical health. And
yeah,
it can be a helpful process, right?
Yeah. And there's
thinking long term.
Mm-hmm. And there's a book that is helpful. I'm partway through it, about three quarters of the way through it. We received it at the Gospel Coalition free.
Yeah.
It's called Crazy Busy by Kevin DeYoung. That is very good. So I would encourage you, if you're a reader, to read that. If not, there's got to be articles and websites we can clue people in if they email us.
Yeah.
So email us.
And I'd say just, we can be high achievers about everything, and we can be high achievers about this too. So just give yourself grace as you figure it out. And if you mess it up one day and you feel like you're really stressed out, well, then you start again the next morning.
Yeah, that's a good
point. And see how it goes. Mm-hmm. Like, it's not going to be, like we said, you're never going to have your life completely in balance, completely figured out. It's a constant juggling act. And just give yourself grace with that, and and allow others to speak into your life on that topic.
Yeah.
So we thought we'd end with Micah 6, verse 8. It's a passage where God is kind of talking to the people of Israel and saying, asking them to identify what he requires of them. And they're putting all kinds of rules on themselves. And he says, in verse 8, he says, "He has told you, O man, what is good, and what does the Lord require of you but to do justice and to love kindness and to walk humbly with your God." And I think if we can keep those things in mind, God's not requiring, like he says in here, 10,000 rivers of oil and your firstborn and the fruit of your body, all these things. He wants you to do justice, to love kindness, to walk humbly with him, and allow him to direct your paths. Mm-hmm. So why don't we just pray to that end, and we will close off. Lord, we just thank you for all the people who are part of our congregation. Thank you, Lord, for so many people who have a passion for serving your church, for serving their families, for serving the community, for doing so many good things in your name. Lord, we just pray that as we do these things, that you would just continually be refining us and reshaping us, Lord, so that we understand your priorities in every situation, so that we let go of the expectations that would be not pleasing to you or not helpful to us, and that we would learn to just rest in your grace and the fact that you just require us to walk humbly with you. Mm-hmm. So, Lord, we just pray for people, especially those who may be feeling that they are burned out, that they're carrying too many burdens. Lord, I pray that there would be wise people who would come alongside them, who would give them advice, who would notice when their eyes seem a bit frantic and when they're blowing up or bursting into tears, Lord. I just pray that there'd be people who are sensitive and caring and kind and compassionate, Lord, and that would help us all to just keep ourselves in check and to have realistic expectations on ourselves and on others. So, Lord, we just pray for our congregants, we pray for ourselves, we pray for all our staff, as we pastors and directors and staff members, Lord, seek to serve the needs of so many people in this church, that we would just keep your perspectives in mind. We pray all these things in your name, Jesus. Amen.
Amen.
Thanks for joining us today. See you later.